we're going to do, we have, I think, nine TAG members who are running for steering committee. Our committee is made up of seven people. So on your ballot, you're going to choose only seven of those candidates who you want to represent you on this committee, and they will be our new committee. What you can do, and this is a good way for me to kind of let you guys know how you can bring forth a proposal to the steering committee to TAG. If you have an idea, some way to make government more transparent, more accountable, or to decentralize the process, you create a proposal, and it doesn't have to be something elaborate, just your idea, how it's going to benefit TAG, or how it's going to benefit the movement, how TAG can help, and how much it's going to cost. You submit that through one of these committee members, and then the committee vets it. And with, you know, it could take a week, and you could have funding for your project to make a difference. And so that's how this committee is designed to work, to be vetting projects like this. So we have multiple candidates, and I will introduce Nick Tanner. Is our first one. They're going to be going pretty quickly because, as Glenn said, we're on kind of a time crunch. We have two awesome bands playing, and so we definitely want to be able to enjoy that music. Nick Tanner is a candidate for Texas House, and he's been involved with TAG for a little while, and I'm just going to let him introduce himself. Nick, you have a minute or two to let people know who you are and why you want to be a member of our steering committee.
All right. Thank you. I really appreciate it. Well, like Heather mentioned, I am running for State House, representing District 47. I'm a first-time candidate. I'm an everyday taxpaying citizen, just like all of you out there who's sick and tired of what's going on. I actually had no idea that TAG existed a year ago, to be honest with you. But now that I've found so many great people that are like-minded and looking to make a difference within the system and within our legislative process, it would be an honor for you to bestow your vote upon me and to give me the opportunity to not only give back to my community, but the state in general. So, I know I don't have very long up here, and I don't want to take too much time, but again, I hope that you'll consider me not only, you know, here in the TAG ballot, but also on November 6th, if you live in the District 47 area. You can also check me out on nicktanner.com, but please, you know, continue to come out and support TAG, no matter who you vote for and who you put on the committee, because we need people. We really do. And nobody else is going to make the differences we need to be made if we don't do it ourselves. So, again, thank you so much. My name is Nick Tanner. I'd appreciate your vote, and I hope you all have a great night.
Thank you, Nick. I'm glad we have quite a few new people running for steering committee. Often it's kind of the same people who are always involved, so I love having the new faces, because we know that the older ones aren't going anywhere. TAG's too awesome for them to just leave. This is to keep coming around. But to keep new blood coming in, new ideas, and new ways of looking at the movement, really, and the objectives that we have. Up next is Jeff Cantoff. He's a current member of the TAG Steering Committee and is running for re-election.
I just want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. I really appreciate it, and I know this might be kind of a far place in Austin to come out to. I had no idea what people were going to get, but thank you so much for coming out tonight. Yeah, I'm running for re-election on it. I would appreciate your vote, and I hope everybody has a great time tonight. Thank you.
All right.
We have to make sure this microphone stays in this radius, guys, or else you will have major pain, okay?
All right, longtime TAG member Nathan Kleffman is running for TAG Steering Committee also.
Hello, everyone. Good to see you out here tonight. My name is Nathan Kleffman. I moved here to Texas a few years ago and been a libertarian for about 6-7 years when I kind of woke up. And I ran for state representative, District 49, in 2010. And I work for a large IT consulting company, and I kind of go out of town every week for work. So that's why you may not have recognized me necessarily from the Monday meetings, because I'm always out of town for work. And anyway, when I ran for office and my company found out, they said, you either need to drop out of the race or take an unpaid leave of absence. I chose the leave of absence because I decided that, you know, I made a commitment to the Libertarian Party of Texas and I was going to see it through. Luckily, they only found out a month before the election. I say that because I'm still with that company, and what I'm trying to do in running for the TAG Executive Steering Committee is to find some way that I can contribute, some way that I can give back, and just and be involved. Heather suggested that I run, and she said, and I first I said, well, I don't know about running. I can't make it to all the meetings. But she informed me that most of the things that we do to the Executive Steering Committee is through email, and that I could do remotely when I'm on the road. So just about me, I'm hardcore radical libertarian and the traditional Murray Rothbard, very serious student of Austrian economics, and have a lot of all the issues that we're concerned about with TAG, fluoride, and everything like that. Big issues for me. And again, with traveling every week, very interested in the TSA, and I give them a piece of my mind about once a month when I end up having to go through the body scanners, but probably out of time. So, and Nathan Kleffman would love your vote, because I'd love to help out and help and give my perspective and help steer TAG's future. Thank you.
Hi guys, I'm Chris Nielsen. But no booze? I was talking with Heather the other day, and or yesterday actually, you know, if it'd be a good idea to run for the steering committee, because you know we I'm not a libertarian, just FYI, but I think that we all agree where it counts. It's government accountability. It's about having civil rights. Economics, okay, maybe we don't exactly see eye to eye there, but I think that I could help out, just be a different kind of voice on the steering committee. You know, sometimes you need people that disagree with you. But, I mean, we've proven to work together well in the past. I'd just like to get more involved. That's really all I had. Thank you.
My name is Glenn Mays. I am currently on the steering committee, and I have made the best choices ever. I do not go for any BS. It allows more government. You'd be surprised what these guys try to pass off on us. You know, they claim they're libertarians, and they're kind of, you know, increasing the state and everything like that. And I voted down. And that's why you need to vote for me for steering committee. Glenn Mays.
I'm currently a member of the steering committee. I'm TAG's liaison for Austinites for Geographic Representation, which has been successful in getting our 20,000 signatures and on the ballot. Actually, the city council just put it on the ballot, and they put a competing measure on there too. I won't get into that, but I'm really excited for the legislative session. I got my first taste of TAG with the legislative session. I want to keep going with that. I love being a steering committee member, and I hope to continue doing that. Thank you.
Thanks, Marissa. I'm going to stand in for Taylor Medding, who couldn't be here tonight, but is very enthusiastic about continuing to serve TAG on the steering committee. She has organized quite a few events, has demonstrated to be very much a leader and a great young lady that is coming forward in this movement and really pushing the peace agenda, which I think and always speaks from coming from a place of love and the peace aspect of this movement. And that's what I really love about it, because she can communicate very effectively when she focuses on those issues. And she served us very well, putting together multiple events, and she's really excited about the legislative session. She participated in 2011, just like Marissa did, and is looking forward to 2013 and would like to serve on the committee again. Her name is Taylor Medding. Up next, I'll bring Sean Ireland. He was a candidate for Austin City Council, and that's how he got involved with TAG.
Sorry I'm late. I was helping some disreputable folks smuggle a large amount of cocaine into the U.S. I did so well, they said I should maybe run for Travis County Constable in 2016. So I have that to look forward to. But in all seriousness, there's one election that I'm focused on right now, and that is for a TAG steering committee. I have a lot of good ideas. I think that I showed, you know, that I what I truly believe in during the city council election. I think that the city council is basically run like feudal France, and it's something that needs to be addressed. Unfortunately, all of Austin right now has some serious buyer's remorse when they look at what the city council has done with voting things into work sessions, and apparently losing $300 million, which was bond money. But I think one of the things that I would like to focus on as a steering committee is to what we would like to focus on is educating voters on the the initiatives on this fall, this November's elections. I think that that is of a primary importance. There's going to be, it's going to be like a Chinese menu. It's going to be like 30 things on there, and a lot of people are going to be confused. And a well-educated electorate is something that we should strive for. So I really appreciate your vote for Sean Ireland for TAG Steering Committee, and I hope to serve you well. Thank you very much. Yeah. And here is, and in the center ring is Dr. Laura Pressley. Actually, Chris has a really good AM driving voice, doesn't he? Chris Nelson? Yeah. That was Woo! Awesome. Anyway, Laura, Dr. Laura Pressley, everybody.
Thanks, Sean. Thanks for running for city council. You took it on the chin there. That was tough. Well, everybody, I'm Dr. Laura Pressley. I ran for city council this last May, and I've been on the steering committee of Texas for Accountable Government. They're a phenomenal organization. And I am on the ballot for this time, but I'd like to actually, I talked to Heather about this, I'd like to take myself off the ballot. There's so many good people, and when we had talked about it just recently, there had not been that many people who wanted to run. So I'd like to take myself off so we can have a lot more diversity and a lot more new ideas on there, but I'm not going anywhere. So. And I think I'm still on the exec group email, so I know what goes on. So please vote for the other people, and I'm taking myself off. So thanks.
Aww. And we have one more candidate for TAG Steering Committee, and I don't believe that she has made it yet. Her name is Katie Brewer, and is she here?
No.
Okay, I haven't seen Katie. Katie Brewer has been involved with TAG since the beginning. She came in right when Ron Paul was finishing up his 2008 campaign when we were founded, and she's been involved every step of the way, has definitely been part of the backbone of TAG in getting things done, and she's had a lot of things going on, didn't get to help with this party, and I realized how much it takes to do an event and how much work she's done and she's put into all of the various events that we've had for TAG over the last 4 years. So Katie Brewer is her name. She's on the ballot, and she is running again and would very much appreciate your vote. I think that's all the candidates, unless anybody wants to do a write-in. Anybody else wants to?
With the ballots, if you haven't gotten a ballot, table up here, and fill out your ballot, and then bring it back up to the table. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Everybody, when you cast your ballots, it's going to be up over here. We'll count them up, and we will make the announcements later in the evening.
All right, next we are going to show a little presentation that Heather so gracefully put together.
No?
Nate Thomas. I'm sorry. I did not know that Nate Thomas put together. If you haven't seen one of Nate Thomas's productions, you're missing out. Seriously, this guy does some awesome work for TAG. He's been our videographer pretty much, and edits all or most of our stuff. Without further ado, Nate. Once again, thank you, Nate. We greatly appreciate that. Thank you. I really appreciate it. All right, so I do want to make one thing clear, okay? TAG is transpartisan, okay? I want to say it again, TAG is transpartisan, all right? We work across all parties, whatever you like, all right? We try to work with everyone. We try to come to a common consensus on issues, okay? That's what we care about, issues. On a national level, it's really hard to make any kind of impact. It's almost impossible, all right? But locally, we have seen that we can work with each other and actually make something happen on the local level, okay? I do want to encourage anyone who would like to run for political office, please do so. This is something that we can't get enough of. As you can tell, it's a circus. And if you like, you know, circus and games and manipulate people, it's a great thing for you, I promise you. Another thing I would like to suggest is that you guys thank Anderson Mill over there, Cole, the ownership here. They're being more than accommodating for us. I really appreciate it. And right now, I really would like to introduce someone that's very special to me in this organization. I'll wait to get everyone's attention for this one. It's kind of serious. I'll wait longer. If you can hear me, clap once. If you can hear me, clap twice. I see people not clapping. As you can tell, I work with kids. As you can tell. I mean, I love it. I love it. Sometimes kids and drinking people, it's kind of the same. It's kind of the same. All right, so I would really like to introduce someone that's special to this organization. Their commitment to what they do is, and on a life, on an everyday basis, is amazing. They just don't put on the hat of activists. They live it every day. They actually work in a situation to where they can provide better health for people. And it's almost a lifestyle now. And that's what I challenge all of you out there, okay? With your activism, don't just wear a hat, make it a lifestyle, you know? You can be the greatest, whatever you can be, go out there and do it, because that's what we need, all right? This person, this lovely lady, I'll go ahead and narrow down for you now. Inquiring minds want to know. Yeah. I'll narrow it down. Okay, this lovely lady has done great research for us. I mean, if she was on my research team, I mean, I would have a lot more money than I have right now. She's done great things for fluoride across Texas, across northwestern, all right, area. Pure Rain is her company. She did one of the greatest things that you can do here in TAG, and that's run for political office. I know how hard that is. I didn't talk to anyone for 3 months after I ran. Cargill, you know what I'm saying, right? It's hard to talk to people. I'm glad to see you out, Cargill. Seriously, I'm glad to see you out. Thank you. It's hard to show up after that, especially, I mean, come on. You want people to vote, you know? You have something that people really need to hear, and then it's like everybody's just on the computer, like, whoa. I mean, there's a lot of people on the computer, but I don't think they're all in Austin. I don't know. But we need to get more people involved, more people out, okay? And this is what Laura Pressley, our people's champion, has done. Thank you. Laura Pressley, please come up here. We have a special award for you. TAG, Second Floor Council of Government, people's champion. She has done so much for our organization. Leif, you have a wonderful wife, seriously. You better be conquering the world, I mean, because she is amazing. All right? Thank you very much. Would you like to say?
That's bringing tears to my eyes. I want to stand up here so I can read this.
Yes.
Yeah. I need some light. I can't say how much I appreciate this. I remember last year when the TAG party, and the people that you honor are really important. And they do a lot of great work. And I can't believe I'm in that category, so thank you. I just want to say that it's an honor just to be able to get such an award for telling the truth. You know, all I do is tell the truth over and over and over again. And I want to thank my husband for being there supporting us for this campaign that we ran. We ran that campaign for 6 months, and it was grueling, as you guys know. And I want to say how much I love you, Leif, and thank you for supporting all of us, because you helped all of us in this room, not just me.
Yeah.
You did. All of us in Austin. You know, over the years, I've learned how much power the truth has. And I want to focus on that a little bit tonight. Our forefathers, the First Amendment was free speech. They somehow knew the spiritual power that the truth has. And I'm going to give you some examples. Throughout the campaign, I saw that so dramatically. How when we would speak the truth, when I would say the truth, there were so many times that people wanted to squash it. They couldn't even hear it. And our forefathers knew this. They knew that free speech was the number one thing for a free society, for those of us that want to have liberty. They knew it. We are really fortunate that TAG's here in Texas. I want to give a hand to them, okay? Can you imagine what would it be like without them here? We would have drones in the city of Austin. I mean, there's so many checkpoints. I can't imagine Art Acevedo would be running rampant without Heather Fazio and John Bush, okay? And all of us. And we can't have Art Acevedo running rampant or that city council. there's many of us that go up there and we tell them the truth, we tell them what we think, and they're scared. And sometimes they have to respond to us. I want to give you a kind of insight of the first time I volunteered for TAG. It was for the TSA. It was the Wednesday before the Thanksgiving when they started the groping. And I'm a sexual assault survivor, so this was very important to me. And I heard on 90.1 about John Bush and Chandra and Matt Wood were going to be out with signs anti-TSA at the airport. It was my first experience, and it was phenomenal. It was so empowering, and I said, I want more of this because we need other people speaking out. And I'm really thankful to TAG for what they do. I want to talk a little bit about the campaign and give some of you were at this one meeting that we had, and it was the Black Austin Democrats.
Oh yeah.
And I was, studying up on all the issues in East Austin for African Americans, and I was ready for all the hard questions they were going to ask. Out of the two questions they asked at that forum, one of the questions was, what African Americans do you know that are supporting Ron Paul? Ooh. Okay, this was the question. They didn't ask about violence in East Austin. They didn't ask about gentrification in East Austin. They wanted to know about Ron Paul because I was a Ron Paul supporter. And I thought about the question and I said, it's not going to matter what I say, so I'm going to go for it. And I answered Martin Luther King Jr. You should have seen my husband's face. And he was so proud of me. And I said, if I'm going down, I'm going down swinging.
Yeah.
Okay? They were furious. They were livid. And again, this is the huge example of the power of the truth. Because Martin Luther King, on April 4th in 1967, the Riverside Church in New York said he did not approve of the war in Vietnam. And I know he would have supported Ron Paul. Okay? They couldn't take it. They couldn't take that truth. They started yelling, and they wouldn't let me finish.
Wow.
And it was shocking. And I just sat back and said, the truth has so much power, we have to keep saying it. And it's the number one thing. That was my most memorable meeting in that whole campaign. Were you in there, Sean?
Yes.
That happened? Wasn't it great?
It was good.
Martin Luther King Jr. Then I was going to also say, well, Gandhi and Jesus too, but I didn't go that far. I didn't get to say that one, but that was next on my list. And I want to just say, even now, I am still up there at City Council, still up their butts, telling them how it could be instead of how it is right now. And I'm a reminder to them of what is different and what other choices they can make. And again, the truth is very painful for them. We spoke about smart meters this week, okay? And you had, there were so many people across the state that came in and talked about their health issues. These commissioners were not happy to hear this. They couldn't tolerate the truth. There was one commissioner that when all the citizens, it was citizens' time to speak, he had to leave. He couldn't listen to it. So I'm telling you guys, truth is so much power. Our forefathers knew it. They knew how powerful it was. I want to thank so many people that helped us with the campaign. TAG, Loride Free Austin, 90.1. We had so many things that our opponent couldn't buy. You can't get a banner on MOPAC, okay? Mel Simpson and Michelle, what they did for us was phenomenal. It was amazing. We had so many things that no one else could buy, and we had them. So, you know what, there's nothing more important than us speaking up for ourselves and speaking up for each other. I believe this life is a test, and we're being tested every day. And everyone in this room has a calling for liberty. You wouldn't be here if you didn't. And there's few of us, if we just speak out, singly we're one voice, but as a group we're incredibly loud, incredibly powerful. And you're here because you have a calling. And I want every single person to think of what they can do to further that message of liberty. Because it's us. It's us in this room. It's a
greatest honor of my life to be able to speak the truth. And I'm very fortunate for all the gifts I've been given. Wonderful husband, my precious daughter. And I think we're all given gifts, and we have to use them. We have to use them. And sometimes it's scary, and, you know, our spirit is there so that we can make a difference. And that's why we're here. I'm not going away. I'm going to continuously stay in city council space.
Woo!
Yeah. Not going away. I'll run again, whether it's under the 10-1, whether it's under the 8-2-1, or whether it's even the system we have now, the at-large. And I'll be there running in 2 years. And I hope I have everybody in their support.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, one more round of applause for Dr. Laura Pressley. Thank you, thank you. Thank you so much for what you've done for us as an organization. Your work does not go unnoticed at all, okay? I'd also like to reiterate some of the things she said. If you were here right now, there's a reason. You're probably at different stages of your pissed off-ness, as I would call it.
Yeah.
All right, there was a time when I was really angry, you know, just like, oh my gosh, this is crazy, something needs to happen, you know what I mean? And then there was like the time that I was like almost burnt out because I was like researching everything and like about to go crazy, you know? Looking at the screen, your eyes are crossed, and you're just like, I just want to know the truth, I want to know too much, you know, I don't want too much. And then there's a time whenever you're like, okay, I have to do something with this energy, I have to do something with the way I feel, with the way that I want to move myself through my life, I have to do something more. So then you start changing your career, you start changing your lifestyles, and then it makes a whole difference because then your activism is your life. It's not no longer anything about you and your mouth moving, it's about your actions. And actions, we all know, speak louder than words. And with that being said, does anybody have a flashlight? I want this guy to get a flashlight in the face, so maybe he'll put me on YouTube.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have another award that we like to give out, and this is for the Activist of the Year. Like I said, this is one of those things. Thank you. Thank you. Come here. Bring that up here. All right. Thank you. Okay, yeah. So anytime you see this on camera, you're like, God, what are you afraid of? You know what I mean? I can show a camera, Mr. Copper, you know what I mean? Like, stop doing that to us, you know what I mean? Like, what are you doing? And just being rude, you know what I mean? You're a rude guy, and it's cool, you know? Anyway, that was my little impression of this next guy. He's done so much good work for us. Antonio Buehler, come up here, please. I truly, truly like to say, you've taken your life now. It's no longer about talking for this gentleman. He does the walking. The Peaceful Streets Project is amazing, and he's done so much great things for the community. I love community people. Thank you. Would you like to say
something? Well, first off, I'm honored to be following Laura Pressley because I think she's amazing. I'll go back even further. I was in New York working in finance. And I was in investment banking, I was in private equity, and I was going down a path which, probably wasn't going to be a good path for me. I mean, I was thinking about becoming a CFR term member, I was actively involved in supporting John McCain for president in 2008. I even organized a group of people to go down to Pennsylvania and knock on doors for him. And after the election was over, I sort of took a step back, and I started to, you know, listen to Barack Obama and listen to the things that he was saying, and a lot of things that he said sounded pretty good now that I was, the election was over, so there was no reason for me just to hate him just because he was a Democrat. And some of the things that he was saying about, you know, respect around the world and, you know, not doing things to harm other people, stuff like that, made a lot of sense. And so I started to say, okay, I'll give this guy a shot. And I actually thought he could have been the greatest president, you know, of the past century if he actually would have followed through on some of his rhetoric. But even before he was inaugurated, he started breaking his promises. And at about that time, I was also watching Ron Paul videos, and that guy really made sense. And he had the background, he had the back history to support what he was saying. And I started to go down this path towards libertarianism, and I've passed that up, and now I'm going down a path towards anarchism. But as most people in this room probably had, you know, there was just a period in my life where things were just like really unfolding really quickly, and I was going down over the cliff, and just like, oh my God, conspiracy theories are true, like really? And I knew that I had to get out of New York. I needed to get out of the situation that I was in. And there were only two places in the country that I could see myself going. One was the Free State Project up in New Hampshire, and the other one was Austin, Texas, because I knew that there were so many hardcore liberty activists here. And so I went to India for 40 days, and while I was over there, I tried to figure it out. And on my flight back, I said, okay, I'm going to go to Austin. And I came down here, and the very first thing I did when I rolled into town with my big U-Haul truck, besides driving past the Capitol about 20 times, seeing if they would pull me over, was I went to a tag meeting over at Big Daddy's. And I felt really awkward there, because there were all these liberty activists. No one's talking to me because I was a new guy. But then I started to go to some of the tag events, and it was really cool just being around people who just really valued their lives and had morals and ethics, and they didn't want to hurt each other. And I came down here to be a liberty activist and to really try to change education, like that was my focus. But through the process, I really found out who I was. I'm doing this because Laura choked. So I really figured out who I was, and you guys aren't liberty activists anymore. You're my community. And you know, it's weird because, you know, I've been a part of a bunch of networks and stuff where, like, you know, alumni networks and stuff where, like, it's supposed to be a really strong group and people are really supposed to stick up for each other. But with the people in this room, I just know you guys do things for the right reasons. You do things because you believe that, you know, violence should never be used to try to coerce people into doing something that you want to do. And something as simple as that, but something that's just not, the society just doesn't realize it. And so I got really active in the Ron Paul campaign, the Ron Paul marches, all that stuff, the anti-war stuff. But then on New Year's, as you all know, I got arrested. And when I was in jail, it was rough, man. Not rough, I mean, people who've been in jail longer than me know that, you know, that's really rough. But just that night when I was thinking, like, you know, well, what's gonna happen to my life? You know, will everyone turn on me? But the liberty community here in Austin and around the country really rallied, and it was really powerful. And without you guys, and the witnesses who stepped forward and the guy who had the video, without you guys, you know, it would have been really, really hard on me. And I don't know that I could ever repay that debt other than just trying to help other people out the same way you guys all helped me. Another thing I love about this group, TAG, and people who've gone down this path is that you guys are willing to put aside the party politics and the ideology and stuff to support each other. And I love the fact that TAG, while it's filled with libertarians and anarchists, we do have our Democrats and our Republicans as well. And people really disagree on a lot of really significant issues. You know, like abortion and immigration, but people here can deal with that because they can focus on philosophy and they understand the person inside that they're speaking to, you know, is a person and their life has worth too, You know, because of the support of you guys, we ended up launching the Peaceful Streets Project, and there were a lot of great people who've been involved, people who aren't as involved now as they were when the thing first started, and people who come in and really have gotten involved now. But, you know, Peaceful Streets Project, we do it in a nonpartisan, non-political way, and because of that, we have an ability to reach a lot more people and get community support. And, you know, a lot of that was driven by just seeing what TAG has done. And, you know, I'm a hardcore libertarian slash anarchist, whatever, well, I guess not anarchist, but I still believe in the state, but I believe that the state exists, that's what I'm saying. And I'm willing to vote, but we have, you know, Comrade, you know, he's a communist, right? And I personally do not believe in communist philosophy, but I know Comrade is one of the kindest people I've ever met. And he always puts the community before himself. And, you know, people like Comrade and Monica Saban and John Bush and Kaya Trichet. You know, I think that through the Peaceful Streets Project, we have a chance to really reshape the way people look at law enforcement in this country. And I think through TAG, we have the ability to take over the city. And when I say take over, I don't mean like the Democrats or Republicans where they take it over so they can enrich their friends. I'm saying we take over the city and we actually become a liberty destination for people from around the world. People flock here because this is a free city. And you know, Laura Pressley gets into city council, Sean Ireland, played a vote, and they always say this, yo, yeah, let's kick the bums out. It never happens. But I think that we can actually do it here. And Boston's my home for life because I think this is the only place in America where we'll see liberty in our lifetimes. And I'm just thrilled to be around all you guys. So thanks a lot for the award. I'm just proud to be here with all you.
Antonio Buehler, please. Give it up. Give it up. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Okay, so we all know that this is TAG's 4-year anniversary. Clap it up, clap it up. With that same excitement, why don't you go over there and sign some of those papers and put some money down, because this is also a fundraiser. We could not do what we do unless we had funds to do so, okay? We've been fortunate to partner with some wonderful people. We have dropped some phenomenal cash on our candidates, and that's just because we have gotten to the position we are for transparency across the board. So give it up for TAG, 4 years. Okay, so also on the silent auction items, okay, there's like two cases of Pure Rain back there. There's two Berkey sports water filters. I promise you, if you're putting tap water in there, you're doing yourself an injustice. You really are. Of course, you haven't done research by Dr. Laura Pressley. Seriously, stay away from tap water. All right, that's nothing against the bar. Appreciate y'all for offering Pure Rain. Thank y'all very much. I greatly appreciate it. Seriously, I didn't know what my throat was going to do if I had to drink tap water here. My wife would kill me. I'm going to introduce, once again, our executive director, Heather Fazio, to announce our volunteer award.
So we heard from two really incredible activists and human beings that have been working with TAG and in our community to make a difference, and we have duly honored them. But it takes a lot more than just two or five people to make something happen. And it takes a lot of people. And there's been a lot of people that have been very involved in TAG and in the movement all year long. And so I just want to take this time. I'm going to rattle off everyone's name, and I want you to come up here with me, please, if you hear your name called. We have Jennifer Wissinger, Katie Brewer, Taylor Menning, Marissa Stewart, Jeff Kantoff, Glenn Mays, Laura Pressley, Trey Reginelli, and Rob Love have all served in a leadership capacity for Texans for Accountable Government. We have multiple members of Texans for Accountable Government running for local office. We have Nick Tanner, Raul Camacho, Sterling Russell, Sean Ireland, Clay Defoe, Michael Cargill, Andy Fernandez, Patrick Dixon, and David Simpson. Everyone come up here with me. If I called your name, come on up. We have Jessica Ellison, who worked on 10-1 and the Keystone Pipeline, Jen Studebaker, Chris Bailey, Linda Curtis for Keystone and 10-1, J- Justin Armand, Nathan Kleffman, Mary Anderson, Mary Krennick, Travis Snavely, Kit Daniels, Jared Barger, Monica Savant, Nate Thomas, and Ray Nadler-Olnick. These are our activists that have really made it happen this year. It takes a lot of different moving parts to make it all happen, and it takes individuals stepping forward and becoming leaders in what's important to them. And that's exactly what these folks have done, and everyone that wasn't able to make it that we're honoring with an activist award tonight. So I want to thank you all so very much for your work. We have t-shirts in the back for $15. We have three different colors. They're all the same style. And they have humanized, harmonized, localized on the back, which I love that we have this on this shirt. And we had it on one of the versions of our last shirt because this motto has really been why we've been able to have so much success. And it's going to be why we continue to have success. When we're humanizing and talking about these issues as human beings and how they affect our own lives, the lives of our family, the children in our community. And once we start speaking from our hearts and talking about that kind of stuff, we're going to start harmonizing with people we don't normally work with and building the relationships that it's going to take to actually make a difference locally, which brings us to localizing the effort. Local and state politics is much less futile than federal politics. And we can see ourselves making a difference because we're focusing on those things. So we have t-shirts in the back, they're $15 each, silent auction. We have a raffle, and it's a 50-50 raffle, which means that the winner of the raffle splits the pot with Tag. 50-50. So get your raffle tickets, we'll be coming around. We have a little bit more to do up here, but we're gonna turn the music on, have the bands come in, and we want everyone to stay and hang out and mingle and meet some new people. I challenge you to introduce yourself to someone in this room that you have not met before, because we're all incredibly friendly, we're all on the same page and working for the same cause, and we need to start meeting each other a little bit more. So it's been an incredible year, and we have a lot of work, we've done a lot of incredible work, we have a lot of work to do. And one of the projects that is going on now, and we've seen already started by a lot of tremendous activists, is the 10-1 citizens redistricting, which will give us districts here in the city of Austin. Right now you vote at large, which means every single person gets to vote for every council member, and good luck getting a meeting with any of the representatives. If we have districts, you'll have one of your neighbors running for city council and serving you on the city council. And so that's what we're focusing on, getting 10 districts, and then the mayor will be voted on at large. There has been a tremendous effort to build this single issue coalition, which is what TAG's all about. And we are proud to be one of the coalition partners of this 10-1 effort, along with the Austin Charter Revision Committee, the Austin Human Rights Commission, the Austin Neighborhood Council, the Austin Police Association is our partner in this effort, if you can believe that. But that's great, because this is an issue we agree on. So if we agree on something, let's work together on it. We have the League of Women Voters, the NAACP, multiple Democratic groups, and the Travis County Republican Party. So you can see that this effort is, in fact, a transpartisan effort. There are members of our community that are of all different political persuasions working together on this effort, and it's been led by Linda Curtis, who, if she's not here already, she will be here soon, and I am very proud to have worked with her and to know her, because she has kicked so much ass on this. She got 33,000 valid signatures turned into city council last month. Yeah. Incredible. That's right. And we have Jessica Ellison, Jen Studebaker, and Chris Bailey, and Marissa Stewart are the TAG members who have been there this whole time. Now, that was the first half of this battle. The second half is going to be, it's on the ballot now. Now we have to get it voted on, and we have to educate our neighbors and our friends and our family about the importance of this initiative on the ballot in November, and get them out there to vote, not only for this initiative, but for the great candidates that we have on the ballot. So that's one of the things that we have going. We definitely need more volunteers. Anything that's going on that you have any interest in, pick one. Pick one thing and focus on that. That's how we're going to be able to make the biggest impact, is when we focus on what we're interested in, what is going to affect our lives in the most meaningful way, and then we just go full steam ahead on it. We have the cocaine constable is not out of our line of sight at all. That guy is still in office. And that guy is still up for election in November. We still have a chance at getting him out of office. And I'm going to be doing everything that I can to make sure that that happens. So immediately, there is some action going. Immediately, we have a candidate that's going to be running against him. We have who's a member. And we're not going to be endorsing for the general election, but we will be supporting Raul Camacho, who is the libertarian in the race, who's running against him. He's prepared to call him out on all of the issues that Michael Cargill did so well during the primary. This is our second shot at getting the cocaine constable out of office, and you better believe that we will be doing everything we can to do that, in spite of the illegal behavior that he'll take part in and his deputies, in order to keep that from happening. Here in Austin, we have non-sworn employees working for APD. We have about 1,000 of them as of today, which means they don't take an oath of office, and they are not bonded by the city, which means they are not agents of government, which means government is not immediately responsible for what they do. Now, I have a big issue with that on a fundamental basis, but I don't know if I'm willing to take on the 1,000 of administrative employees, secretaries that they already have. What I want to focus on is the PERF report, the Police Executive Research Forum report that the city of Austin paid $100,000 for. That tells us, of course, we need more cops, but specifically they want civilians, they want non-sworn officers working in the Fusion Center and in the Real-Time Crime Center. That means that these people who have not taken an oath to uphold the Constitution and the laws of the state and who are not bonded by the city of Austin are going to be privy to this very sensitive intelligence and information that they're collecting. And what worries me the most is having people in there that don't have a commitment to working as a public servant and them being not willing to come forward because of what they see. They're just an employee. They're just doing what they have to do. When you take an oath, so many people really take that to heart. So many people take that to heart, and it should be said, and we should have people that are accountable to us directly if they're working in intelligence, with intelligence gathering and sharing. So that's one thing, that's another thing that we're battling, and that's on the city level. But right now what we're doing is preparing for 2013. If we have to get ahead of the curve if we want to actually make an impact in the way that the bills are processed and bills passed in the legislative session. That's why we're starting now. We've started with legislative training workshops. We just had two of them recently, one in Austin and one in Houston, and they were both well-attended, very interested people in learning how the process works and how they can further get involved. We're creating our Legislative Action Network, which is a network of activists just like you, who we're going to have categorized so we know what district you're in, so that when your representative introduces an egregious bill, or is on the committee that's hearing a terrible bill, we can call you or email you directly and you can contact them, because your voice means a lot more than 100 of us from throughout the state. So when we have these targeted and we can build that relationship so you know your representative, they know where you stand. I know that Senator Ogden knew where I stood on the TSA bill last session. He knew that. Every time. Ms. Fazio, yes, we know where you stand on this. Okay, well, it's Tuesday, so I'm just calling to let you know. We're still on the same page on all of this. And so building that relationship is important. So we want to make sure that we can give you the information about the issues that you're interested in and the bills that your legislator is hearing or writing or sponsoring or any of that. And that's underway. Our next legislative workshop will be next month in late September. And we will be doing it on Texas Legislature Online. There are a tremendous number of resources at our disposal because of activists that have come before us who have made government more accountable than it was when they were dealing with these issues that we can take advantage of. Texas Legislature Online is an online resource where we can watch bills that are coming through. We can tag bills that are of interest to us subjects. So if you're interested in making sure that the Department of Homeland Security in Texas is not passing checkpoints, or not passing GPS tracking devices without a warrant, you can stay up to date on this, and it's going to take all of us doing it, working together. It can't be a centralized effort with TAG. It has to be everyone involved in what's important to them, and that's what this legislative network is all about. So we have sign-up sheets, and I encourage you to please sign up for that. One thing that we're starting is we're working with Salesforce, which is a customer relationship management. So that's going to be our data, kind of our data management with administratively, but we're also opening up an account called Chatter. And what Chatter is a way that we can network like we do on Facebook. It really is almost just like Facebook. You can upload documents, pictures, there's a news feed, you can do statuses, you can tag people, you can create groups and work within the groups, and that's what I look forward to doing. The very first group I created was Unelecting the Cocaine Constable as my test group, and I need you guys in there so that you can join the group and help us in these various efforts. So we'll have a group for every project, and you can pay attention to the issues that are most important to you and take a leadership role if you are so inclined. The legislative session starts January 13th. They introduce bills 6 days after they're elected. They waste no time. So that means that in November, the second week in November, on that Monday, we are going to be watching the 5,000 bills that come through the House in Texas alone. And I'm going to need your help to do that. So I need you to sign up for this Legislative Action Network so that we can all work together on all of this. The Laura Pressley campaign continues. She is, like she said, she is not going anywhere. And to be real honest, if you want to run for office and represent the people in your community, it takes more than 6 months of running for office. It takes that building of the community, building relationships, letting people know who you are, what you're about, and building your team. And with 46% in 6 months, imagine what we're going to do in 2 years.
Yeah.
So with that is going to continue. She's still pounding the pavement, going there, going down to city council, holding them accountable, going to various groups. I'm so proud to know her and to work with her. And she's going to continue to do this, not only for herself, but for all of us also. So she needs your help, and I hope that you'll stay involved with her campaign and donate when you can. And then the last thing that I want to talk about, and this is us trying to get ahead of the curve. Right now we're in an election cycle. Next year we'll be in the legislative session in the spring. During the summer is when we need to start thinking about getting our people, that's us in this room, running for office. Because when you run for office, you have a platform to stand on where people who aren't normally listening to you or don't normally care what your opinion is, they'll call you. The media literally calls you when you're a candidate on the ballot to ask you, what is your opinion of this or that? And the community groups, the most involved people in the community, are calling you and asking you, Phil, please fill out my questionnaire. Can you make it to our forum? We want to know how you feel about this issue. And that is an incredible opportunity for us to take advantage of. And with the community rallying behind you, you will have the support that you need to get through that campaign, just like Laura, just like Michael, just like every other candidate who's run for office. So that's going to be getting started soon. Any of us can do it. Jump on the ballot. I'm thinking about what race I'm going to run for.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I'll be up for president.
We'll have to wait 9 years for president, but by then we might be ready. So we have, and one of the initiatives that's going to be on the ballot, which Robert, I'm going to let Robert Morrow come up and talk about this because he's done a little bit more research, but you may have heard that they're trying to increase taxes so that they can create a medical school at UT, which has billions of dollars in private investors.
Yeah.
So Robert Morrow is going to be leading the charge on this because this is absolutely something that we can stop at the ballot box because people do not want taxes raised. We want to be healthy, right? We want to be safe. We want all of those things. We do not need to do it with the taxes by increasing taxes. So I'm going to let Robert Morrow come up and speak on this, and then Glenn's going to come back up here. But I want to thank you all for coming and for being involved in all of these things as we move forward because we need everyone putting in any kind of effort that they can so that we can make a difference. Here's Robert Morrow.
Yeah. Y'all hear me?
Yes.
All right, fabulous. I'll be sweet to the point right here. On the ballot this fall, there will be a proposition put up by Central Health, which is an offensive name to begin with.
Yeah.
Central Health. And it is a proposition to raise property tax on every single property owner in Travis County by 5 cents on every $100. That sounds small, but it's a gargantuan tax increase. Probably the biggest tax increase in Travis County
in 20 years, as I can remember. This is going to be a very unpopular proposition because, unlike 8 years ago when the hospital district was created, this time everybody gets slammed with a tax increase, not just the outlying county areas. So it's being promoted by Kirk Watson and Rick Perry, which ought to tell you something. And it's set to raise $540 million over a 10-year period, and then they want to borrow, or they want to get huge amounts of money from a federal government that is $16 trillion in debt. So the bottom line is the median home would pay $1,000 over the next 10 years for this outrageous tax. Every person who lives in Travis County, whether you're a homeowner or a renter, or you buy at Barton Creek Mall, or you buy at Lakeline Mall, every single one of those rents will be passed on to you. So, get ready to kill it, okay? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Robert Morrow. Greatly appreciate your research and hard work. Seriously, this guy, if you want a block walk, talk to this guy. He knows the deal, seriously. He's got it down to his science, all right? One more thing I need to address, okay? If you have not voted for steering committee, please do so. It's right over there. We are about to collect all the ballots. I think we almost have all the ballots. But please, go vote. You have to be a member of TAG, and you have to be in this party, which is $20. And I guarantee you all will be taking care of that, so you might as well vote. All right, another issue. Somebody take a picture of me, please, because I need a new profile picture, and I'm looking kind of, you know, dapper dan today. So I'm just saying. The ballots are up at the table. Bert, thank you very much. I mean, don't get any beer signs, you know what I mean? Thank you. Now y'all see that, you know what I mean? Okay, y'all know where it's from. Okay, I'd like to introduce someone that just ran for constable. All right, in precinct 2. Oh, I'm sorry. What's that? Oh, constable in precinct 2. Michael Cargill with Central Texas Gunworks. Give you a little plug. Maybe I get a free glass or something like that. You know what I mean? Please come up here, sir. Michael Cargill, he's done a lot for this. And the silent auction, please remember about the silent auction, okay? We're about to close that down here in just a little bit. We got Rothbard on the mic coming up. We got John Bush. He's about to get a high. Hey, if we get him the flow, I mean, I promise you, you want this guy to flow, okay? Anyway, Michael Cargill.
What's going on? How you guys doing? All right, we're doing a lot of good things. I'm glad everyone came out. It's important that you get involved in your local elections. Important you get involved in what's going on around this country, you get involved in what's going on in this city. My hat's off to all the people that have run for office. We gotta put these people to the task. We need to stay on target, stay on the message, and continue to push them. And with that, there are a couple people that I brought with me tonight. Because there are some things that happened in my election where we're not letting off of. We're continuing to push forward. I'm not gonna run and hide. We're not going to be disappointed, you know, and go to our home and just, you know, be all embarrassed or sad. We're going to push them to the task. So we filed a lawsuit. We filed a lawsuit against the constable himself. We filed a lawsuit against the county attorney. We filed a lawsuit against the Texas Democratic Party, against the Travis County Democratic Party. Within an hour after us filing this lawsuit, the constable's attorney dropped his lawsuit that he filed against us. Yeah! Within an hour after filing this lawsuit, his attorney quit. Within days of filing this lawsuit, the county attorney himself came to my attorney, pulled him into a little corner and said, hey, he's probably going to be upset because I'm telling you this. He said, hey, can you please drop me from that lawsuit? And I told him, no, we're not doing that. Yeah. We're going to sue you, we're going to sue your mother, and everyone else. There are a couple people that are special to me I want to bring up. There's one person whenever I attend any function that it's a 51% where I'm not allowed to carry a firearm. I have to bring this person with me because with the concealed handgun license, this person can actually carry a gun in a bar. So I want to introduce and want to bring up. We have a dignitary in the house. Ladies and gentlemen, Judge Lynn Bass. Bass. Yeah. And while Judge Bass is coming up, I also like to bring up someone that I always talk about, you guys have never ever seen. He actually stands in the background. He doesn't like for anyone to know who he is. know, but I want to bring him up anyway. My other half, my same-sex partner, he's going to kill me. Bernard, come on up, Bernard. And then also, I want to bring up my legal team, the one who's going against the county. Like I said, we're filing a lawsuit against the Texas Democratic Party. We're filing a lawsuit against the Travis County Democratic Party, the county attorney, and also the constable himself. These people are so afraid that they went to the commissioner's court last week and begged for the commissioners to allow the county attorney to hire an outside attorney with your tax dollars. They're going to try to defend themselves in court. So I'd like to bring up my legal team from the law office of Craig Sandlin. He's coming up. Yes. And I'll let them tell you real quick about the lawsuit and what's going on with that and give me like an update on that lawsuit.
Hi there. My name is Craig Sandlin. I'm the attorney in charge of this case. I have a legal team. I have Jerry Bailey. I have Shannon Hamilton. I have Ernest Alamazoo. Being an attorney is never easy. Sometimes you have to roll up your sleeves and get your hands dirty. This is one of those cases. I think some wrong was done here. This is political litigation. It can be costly. And Mr. Cargill is going to need a lot. Michael's going to need moral support. I'm going to pass it to Ernest and let him tell you something.
Thank you so much for having us. For laypersons like yourselves, understand that political litigation is almost like the death penalty in terms of the cost of
trying to back off this mic, I can really go. Political litigation is very costly, almost like capital murder cases, because there's so many nuances and there's so many levels to the case. Is the municipal aspects of it, is the election aspect of it, there are county and state aspects of it, and some of the wrongs with respect to Mr. Cargill, some of the wrongs are federal wrongs. So there's going to be some federal litigation. There's civil rights issues. We haven't even dealt with the fact that there may be an issue with respect to him being a same-sex candidate. So what you all need to understand is that he deserves to have this fight fought. But it's a very difficult and costly fight. It's an uphill fight, it's a dirty fight. The other side's not gonna play fair. One of the things you know about major cases, whether it's Brown versus the Board of Education or Roe v. Wade, these cases are very difficult and they're very, very slow. Some of the stuff is happening very fast, like the temporary restraining order, the temporary injunction, the permanent injunction, some of the physical contact and intimidation and stuff that he was threatened, bumped, knocked, chipped, those kind of stuff. Those cases respond require police intervention or filing police complaints. But the election contest is another factor that's involved in this litigation. So when you realize that we're running sometimes two, three, and maybe four tracks of litigation simultaneously, and it's going to be probably a need for witnesses at some point. So I want to give you an idea, he can't do it by himself. And the other thing that you need to be mindful of is the fact that a case like Michael Cargill's case may have far-ranging, far-reaching implications. We never knew that Roe v. Wade was going to be as expansive and as pervasive as it ended up being. We never knew that Brown versus Board of Education would have the impact that it had at the time. So you go forward because it's the right thing to do, but sometimes you're not initially aware of how far and how deep the impact of certain litigation is going to be. And in some of the cases that parallel Mr. Cargill's case, it may even have a tremendous impact on the political landscape for Democrats and Republicans, both with respect to the election process. You know that Texas is one of those venues that's included in the whole Juneteenth Confederacy, slavery issues, and a lot of civil rights issues that Texas is a part of. Texas is also involved in federal litigation as far as redistricting is concerned.
So a lot of these issues are tangential or, in fact, a direct connect. Election suppression is another issue that is raised in Mr. Cargill's case. So you begin to realize that he's not just a nobody. He may be not well known in the political landscape here in Austin, but the other side, and we got Boweevil Democrats too. We have some Democrats who are Democrat in name only, who act Republican. But it's important for you to understand that they clearly understand that he's not part of that inside network. He's a Jimmy Carter type. He's a guy who was a salt-of-the-earth kind of person who's running because he feels that he has some principles that parallel with the people's principles. He wants to put forth a campaign that he feels will carry the values of this community. And there are some folks that have well dug in and who are comfortable with the good old boy way of doing things who don't want to budge or nudge. If you want to budge and nudge for other ethnic groups, and they want to budge and nudge for women, and they want to budge and nudge for lesbian and gay. So we know who those people are. They're not going to lay down nicely and say, hey, here are the keys to the kingdom. Come and take it over.
All right.
Yeah.
He's hiding out, but I gotta introduce Judge Glenn Bass.
Come on,
Judge. Judge Bass, this is one person that we've got to support come 2014. Judge Bass is the JP for Precinct 2. JP for Precinct 2, and he's here today. Judge Bass.
I didn't know he was gonna give me the mic, and I would have dressed up for this, but I guess in a group of freedom-loving folks, I guess it's okay, and so long as my thing doesn't mess with your thing, you're okay with my thing. It's really hard to get me dressed up on a Saturday, but it's good to be in a room with so many people who love liberty and freedom. I have a lot of friends in the group here that I didn't know were going to be here today, but it's good to see you, Jerry, Cohen, and others. So my thanks to you for letting me hang out with you today. And stay plugged into what you're doing and following local politics. Local politics is where it's at. It impacts your life more so than some of these other offices at the federal level. Local government absolutely affects your life day in, day out. My thanks to Dr. Laura and Sean and others who have put their name out there and gotten on the ballot. Mike, it is tough being out there and being the candidate. But the candidates couldn't do it without the support of groups like yours. So thank you for all you're doing, and I look forward to coming back to you and asking for your help, walking neighborhoods and helping me with the work that I'll have in 2014. Thank you.
All right, thank y'all very much. Thank y'all very much. Greatly appreciated. Moving right along. Oh, and Judge Bass, I have a program in Precinct 2 at Vernon, so you might as well approve that because I'm on the steering committee, buddy. All right? Maybe we can work something out. I know how politics work. You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. You know what I mean? Scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. You know what I mean? Maybe we can set something up. Right? It's called a nonprofit called Life Changers, by the way. I believe we're trying to make it up there. Yeah, anyway, we'll talk about it afterwards. Yeah, we got to talk. We'll talk about it later. All right, so another thing we have to address is steering committee members, we are wrapping that up, okay? And with one announcement, and then we are bringing up one of my favorite guys. I hope he can just bring on the mic to introduce the band and just flow right into it. Okay, Heather Fazio once again.
Can we hear it for Glenn, our MC for tonight? Before the John Bush comes up, we have a raffle going on tonight. Tickets are $3 a piece, and what we're doing is called a 50-50 raffle, which means the winner of the raffle wins half of the pot. They split it with Tag, split the pot with Tag. So I'm going to be going around and selling raffle tickets. We're going to keep that going until about 9 o'clock, and then we'll make the announcement after Rothbard is done playing. And so I want to encourage you to buy this. I'm sorry there was some confusion about what the prize was, but the prize is cash money. F-R-N. So without further ado, I will introduce to you the John Bush.
How's everybody doing tonight? Give it up for peace and freedom. And for Texans for accountable government! Yay! 4 years, man, it's been a really long time. I have the pleasure of being here for the whole 4 years.
through thick and thin, and man, we've really come a really long way. I remember when it was just an idea in Chuck Young's head, and we started having meetings and hashing things out. At one point, we were going to be called the Wolfpack, Working and Organizing, Liberty and Freedom. I think that was Mel Mason's name, he was mentioned earlier. So yeah, there's several people in here that have been around since the beginning, and I think more importantly, of equal importance that there's people that have been here since the beginning, but also there's so many faces that I've never seen in my life, so it's a testament that shows that Texans for Accountable Government is still vibrant, and there's still new people coming around. We're still remaining relevant. I remember the Austin Chronicle. I was a little offended at first, although I knew it was untrue, but it's even more untrue. They are haters, and haters gonna hate. Especially if they benefit from stolen money with South by Southwest. But they labeled Texans for Accountable Government. I think this was their first mention of us when we were fighting the Proposition 2 Stop Domain Subsidies. It was gonna be $65 million, then we ended up in a recession in subsidies. But they labeled us a faux organization of loony libertarians. Conspiracists, they called us as well. Well, 4 years later, we're still more relevant than we've ever been, and we're still getting blasted by the Chronicle, and we're still pushing back, and we're pushing back in a major way. We're pushing back in a very consistent way, too. And we've grown, and we've had our growing pains, but I think TAG's one of the more regular anti-establishment political organizations that exists, and it takes a lot to go after the establishment, and many of the people in organizing positions in this group and the people running for office, I mean, sure, it's a pain in the butt, but a lot of stuff we're doing, we could potentially put in our lives in danger going up against the police state, the Department of Homeland Security, and the police corruption and the networks that go really deep and all the fraud going on and Antonio Buehler's going toe-to-toe with these police officers. We got Michael Cargill involved in a case against the Texas Democratic Party and Travis County Democratic Party. Takes a lot of huevos to do that kind of stuff. And some people may think our philosophy is extreme, the idea that we should leave each other alone and live peacefully and respect each other's equal liberty. And we've been seen as extremists in the beginning. But more and more, the eyes of the message of freedom is becoming more respected. And it seemed crazy and kooky and weird early on when we would push the message of freedom at city council and city hall and publicly. But now I think a lot of the people that are of the more mainstream status quo idea that we should use government to solve all our problems are beginning to see more and more that ideal is bunk and it's a failure. And here we are offering alternatives and another way of thinking. And we're doing it in a consistent manner. And we're really stepping it up. And people are starting to notice. We were covered in the Southern Poverty Law Center, for example. An organization that started as a civil rights organization, but soon it became a propaganda arm of the Department of Homeland Security, labeling those who oppose the idea that we should centralize power in the federal government as potential domestic terrorists. They covered our anti-Agenda 21 activism. So I just want to thank everybody for sticking in the fight. Every single individual in this room, for staying around, for the new people that are getting involved, because this is going to be an ongoing battle, and we're right on the precipice of actually seeing some genuine political victories. And as Chuck Young said when he spoke to us at a TAG meeting recently, really what's going to determine what kind of organization TAG is how our candidates act when they're actually in office. Because we're right there, and we're consistent, we subscribe to the idea that you shouldn't force people to do things against their will. And we're doing that in a political arena, which seems counterintuitive, but we're still actually making some headway, and we're actually on the precipice of putting people in office that agree with those ideas. And just recently, we've broken through to really becoming a competitor when it comes to fundraising and pulling some money in. For the longest time, we were strictly grassroots organization. We're still 100% grassroots. But for the longest time, we operated. First couple of years was about $5,000 to $6,000. We would remain in the budget all the time. And then we bumped up to around $10,000. This last election cycle, we raised over $50,000 for Texans for Accountable Government. And even though most of the value of this organization comes from the hardcore, dedicated grassroots activism, the volunteer work, and sticking to the ideals and remaining consistent, whenever we have money in our coffers, we're able to be that much more powerful. And with all the stuff coming up, Laura Pressley's running again, the Texas legislative session, this will be our third time to get involved in the Texas legislative session. We had a major impact the first two times with $0. This time, imagine if we can push some propaganda. So at this point, I want to call on everybody to participate, and let's see if we can raise, for the past 4 years that we've been in existence, if we can raise $250 right now for each one of those years. It's $1,000 total. All it would take is for four people to pull their checkbooks out or pull their wallet out or put their credit card on one of these little fundraising slips at $250, or 10 people to give $100, one person to give $500, one person to give another $100, and whatever, eight people to give whatever the math is. So let's see if anybody can do it right now, because I guarantee you, Texans for Accountable Government has absolutely zero overhead. We've shown that for the past 4 years, we can remain consistent and effective, and the future holds essentially what everybody in this room puts into it, in both their dedicated activism and volunteer work, and we need more people to put their money where their mouth is, because the sky's the limit with this organization and the leadership and the volunteer base. So if anybody wants to start off, do I hear $100? Anybody willing to donate $100 to Texans for Accountable Government so we can keep it up and keep fighting and take it to the next level, put some more ads in the Chronicle, push this 10-1 issue, donate $2,500 to Robert Morrow's push to get $50,000 for this Central Health. I guarantee you.
Or become a sustaining...
We got...
Right here. $250.
$250. Pat Dixon's going to be one of those four. Thank you so much, Pat. Anybody else? Laura Pressley. $100. Laura Pressley, thank you so much for everything you do. So that's $350. Anybody else? $650. We had two people donate $100. We'll put it to the cause. That's $550. We're more than halfway there. $1,000, I guarantee. I've seen a lot of different and met and worked and coalesced with multiple different liberty organizations, and this is one of the most efficient organizations in the entire country when it comes to bang for your buck and sheer power. Nathan Kleppen, $250. All right, let's do the math. That's $900 right there. All we need is $100 more. Barry? Oh, that's $800? Oh, I'm a political science major. And a fool. All right, so then we got $150 left. Anybody? We're so close. This money will be used to further the cause of liberty. $50, Jeff Cantoff, steering committee member. All right, $100 left, ladies and gentlemen. Jerry Ward? $100? Jerry Ward, $100. That's $1,000. Woo-hoo-hoo! All right. That was great. Anything else? Yes, more. What's that? Central Texas Gun Works, another $100. That's $1,100. Can we take it to $1,500? Let's go ahead and do $250 for next year. That's $1,250. $150 more dollars. Anybody? $50. Three people. $50. Anybody? $50 right there. We need $100 more dollars. Antonio Buehler, $100. $50. $50. One more. All right. That's some Flores. That's $50. We got it. $1,250, ladies and gentlemen. Thank each and every one of you for coming out and everything that you do to make Texans for Accountable Government, in my opinion, the most successful liberty activist organization in the whole country. Yes. The sky is the limit, and in the future, if it's going to happen anywhere, we will be free here in Central Texas. Yes. Thank you. Yes. Hold it up! Yes. Everybody, stay around. We have Rothbard coming on. Everybody, stay around. Enjoy yourself. Now we party! Thank you very much. I'm Glenn May.
We call ourselves Rothbard. Any Rothbardians happen to be in the house? Awesome. People that don't believe that pointing guns at people is a civilized way of solving problems. Imagine that. I'm going to go ahead and introduce the band. On the drums we have Bank of America, or BOA for short. My name is Captain J.P. Morgan Chase. And of course over here we have, certainly not last but not least, we have the Vampire Squid, Goldman Sachs. That's our names for this song anyway. Thank you.
those black tears are washed away. Don't have much fun. Life is a little fun. But now it's come warm. You're in the eye of the storm. You're all doom to gloom. You're saying this could be fun. But it seems you're too. When you see how good things can be.
Let's go.
you.
All right, I wrote this next song. If you guys want to hear it, you don't really have a choice, so you might as well act like you like it. Cisco. Sure some of you remember him. You know what I'm talking about.
alone at night. Nothing to say. They get the wrong address. Doesn't matter anyway. We'll still get our kicks. We'll still have our fun. We are the SWAT. We are adrenaline junkies till the drugs are wrong.
Let's contemplate the uncomfortable facts. Everything's right in the face. No, you.
Probably do the songs like this. Mr. Politician, you just don't understand the cost of nation building and policing for lands. So you send our sons and daughters off to fight your foreign wars without a declaration. What are they fighting for? On foot patrol in helmet, they never stood a chance. Blown to bits by an IED in front of all their friends. And the ones that tried to save them, well, they lost their young lives too. Mr. Politician, they're dead because of you. Well, you hurt so many families and loved ones left behind. You refuse to change your course, demanding patriotism blind. So you send our sons and daughters off to fight your foreign wars. But without a declaration, what are they dying for? Politician, how do you sleep at night? Your head is full of magic and your words are full of shite. Too many wounded warriors, young lives lost too soon. Mr. Politician, they're dead because of you. Mr. Politician, they're dead because of you. Rising out of sight, and the dollar is the sign of the show tonight. What the dollar used to get us, now we'll buy a head of lettuce. Though the economic forecast isn't bright, what a mystic cloud, I spot a shining ray. I can even glimpse a new and better way. I've devised a plan of action, worked it out to the last fraction, going into action today. I'm changing my name to Fannie Mae. I'm headed up to Washington, D.C. I'll be glad they have my back, so headed for Freddie Mac. It'll be perfectly acceptable to me. I'm changing my name to Fannie Mae. I'm headed for that great receiving line. So I have a million grand out. Creditors are screaming for their dough. I'll be glad to tell them all where they can go. They won't have to scream and holler. They'll be paid to the last dollar. Where the endless streams of money seem to flow. I'll be glad to tell them all that they can do. It's a matter of a simple form or two. It's not just remuneration. Education, but you're kind of glad that I'm in debt to you. I'm changing my name to Fannie Mae. I'm headed up to Washington, D.C. I'll be glad they have my back. We've been struggling in an unrelenting climb. We were hardly up and walking before money started talking. And it's sad to see this failure such an awful crime. Well, it's been that way for millennium or two. Now it seems there's a different point of view. If you're a corporate Titanic and your failure is gigantic, in Congress there's a safety net. thanks to Heather and Katie. Appreciate the opportunity. Okay. We got two more.
But not for drinking.
Thank you so much.